Okay, and you know, anybody, any question, right? I'll let you go.
I'm a big supporter of the fair tax. The state charge 25, and there's 66 congressmen in the sponsor, and including plus 9 senators on the bills. Goodlett is not, has never been a sponsor. Would you support the fair tax, HR 25?
You know, I've given that a lot of thought. I will support it as a sponsor, okay? But I'm going to tell you this right now, and I've said this before. I'm on record many, many times of saying it, okay? My problem with the fair tax is it's revenue neutral. I'm going for something that's revenue negative. I like the fair tax because one of the first things that the fair tax does is repeal the 16th Amendment, which, oh, by the way, is on my list of things to do. Okay, so we're going to work that. I would definitely sign on because I am enough with those folks. Now, when it comes time to do the law, they say, oh, we got to do 23% revenue neutral. I'm going to say revenue neutral. Why? Go to the Constitution. You can buy on 20% of what you're spending right now if you did it constitutionally. And so. Yeah, that's my position. But yeah, I definitely sign on to it. Absolutely. If there's 66 or 67 or 70 guys or guys and gals are doing it, I'll add my strength.
Currently, two Republican congressmen from Virginia, the first and second Virginia congressional district, are on the
bill. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you really should pressure Goodlatte to take a stand on that because it's worth it to. I know you have. Okay. You and then you, because I know you had your hand up.
I like what I hear. I like your passion. And you're as angry as I am. So what do we need to do in this room to support you and get your name out there?
Yeah. I'll tell you, there's lots of different things you can do. Little things like getting on our mailing list so you know what we're doing and following what we're doing with our website and our...
Is the website up there?
No, well, it's really small. Karen Kane for Congress. What I really think you can do, obviously money is good, but I'm not here to ask for money. I think the most important thing you can do is to educate your friends and neighbors, particularly the conservative ones, but I don't care if you educate the liberals either, because they hate Goodlatte too. I'll tell you, I'm not prejudiced about a Democrat vote for me in the primary. Come on, do it. You know, I'm fine with that. But educate the people that you know, and when you hear them complaining about government, say, we have a choice. Sixth District has a choice. It's a conservative constitutional choice. And educate them and spread the word that way. And stay up with what we're doing on the campaign. I would also, and this helps me, but it's not part of our campaign. When Goodlatte, particularly Goodlatte, because he is the target, he is what we are going to take down. But when he comes out and talks to you and talks to groups that you're with, ask him the hard questions and video his answers. That helps me hugely. Yeah. But put him on the spot. Make him earn his money. He may not have much longer for that job. Make him earn his money. Oh, and I promised this guy. I'm sorry.
Okay, sorry.
Following up what he was saying, when you first started playing that video, he was saying even with the taxes and everything, we'll never be able to achieve what we're looking for. Would the fair tax make it better to achieve that, or would we be more behind?
Well, the fair tax, as it's written, is a revenue neutral, okay? And two things with that. Both of these things are going to sound opposite. First off, revenue neutral is not going to get us there. We know this, right? Second off, we have unconstitutional government in this country that is doing way more than it needs to do. So revenue neutral doesn't work for me either. I say we take their money away and deal with the problems. And here's how do you do it when we run out of money ourselves? Okay? I got a kid. I got four kids. One of them can't handle a credit card. He's got a family. He's got a wife who can't handle a credit card either. So the two of them together are peas in a pod. Okay? What do? They blow money. They get in debt. At some point, they had to start selling stuff. At some point, they had to, take the scissors and get rid of that. They had to call credit card companies and say, can you renegotiate? Okay, so that's what people do when they get in over their head. This country's in over its head financially, not because of you and I. It's not because people said, oh, I need my Social Security. That's not it. That's not why we're over our head. We're over our head because Congress spends too much money. The Federal Reserve prints it and borrows it, lends it out, and we borrow it from anybody who'll give us a penny. Okay, so what are we going to have to do? We're going to have to renegotiate our foreign debt. Okay? We're going to have to renegotiate our domestic debt, our obligations. We're going to have to means test some people. If you are a retiree who's 75 years old, and you've got a house in Florida and a golf membership down there, and you got a house in Michigan and a golf membership down there up in Michigan, we may have to say to you, yes, I know you paid. You paid hundreds of thousands of dollars over your lifetime. Guess what? It was a Ponzi scheme. We took your money, we gave it to other people who now have passed away. Okay? And none of your money exists anymore. Guess what? You're not going to be on the street. We have to means test you. And this is coming. I'm not advocating it. okay? Because I think we owe people that are living what we promised them, okay? And we took the money from them. They didn't get a choice, you know. Try not paying your Social Security. So we've got certain people who it's more honorable to pay them. We have other people who were speculating on America's goodness. The Chinese, and I'm not anti-Chinese. I am not anti-Chinese. I shop at Walmart. Most of the stuff in my house probably made in China, and I'm not sure if that's not the same for a lot of people. Okay, so I'm not anti them, but they don't rule us. And much of the reason that they and some other countries, Japan is another example, Great Britain is another example. One of the reasons that those countries lent us a lot of money is first off because we said, hey, you know, we got collateral. Oh, that's all this ground and beautiful countryside we're living on. Yeah, we got collateral. We want the money. But also they were saying, well, like the Saudis when there was a peak oil, when they were making lots of money. You know, what are they going to do with all the dollars? We can't spend all this stuff. Well, Americans want to borrow it. We'll do that. We'll invest our money in Americans. They'll pay us interest back. So there are people that are of a different category of who you pay back. And the speculators don't get paid back. They take risk when they lend. There are people that speculated on this country. There are countries and banks that speculated on this country. And we bailed out some of them. We bailed out some of those banks in New York City who speculated on this country. Okay? We shouldn't have done that. That was very wrong. That was morally wrong. Should have been legally wrong. Very wrong. But anyway, some people we owe the money to. Okay? Close to home, close to heart. Americans, American interests. Okay? And then others are going to have to take pennies on the dollar, just as we do when we go broke on a credit card. We say, well, you know, I borrowed money on a car and I sold it and I only got $5,000, but I owe you $16,000. Guess what? Pennies on a dollar.
So like, you're advocating, and what I'm advocating is that we don't raise any more debt ceiling at all. Just
absolutely
stop
not.
Where we
absolutely.
Are.
Should have stopped before July.
And start cutting back.
Absolutely. And I think, now this hurts people's pride as Americans, and it certainly hurts the Congress, because it hurts the ability for them to borrow more money. Because what happens when you go bankrupt? I don't know if anybody here has done it.
You lose your credit.
Yeah, and oftentimes you find people don't want to talk to you. People don't want to give you big old loans so you can buy a big old mansion, because that last one you had kind of went belly up on them. So we're going to have to renegotiate. We're going to have to do it like a bankrupt. And that is insulting to our sense of pride in this country, but here's what I'm going to tell you. People here in this room, and conservatives and constitutionalists everywhere in the country, we are proud of the founders. We're proud of the gift that the founders left us. We're proud of our system that we believe traces back to the founders and their inspiration, okay, and divine guidance also. We are proud of that. We treasure that, okay? Does anyone who treasures that think that Washington, D.C., with 22.5 million government employees, lording over every segment of your life, is part of what the founders envisioned? I'm happy to treasure and be proud of what the founders left us, and the rest of it is chaff. That's how I see it. Now, we gotta take care of the human beings in this country. Our old people, our elderly people who might be sick, our young people who might be sick, those Medicare people, all those people on Medicaid, a lot of them are young families. They're people that are uncovered otherwise, the ones that are gonna be adding on, a lot of those guys are kids. So, you know, we gotta care about Americans, and we gotta make some judgment calls. But people who speculated on this country, including Americans who speculated on this country, American banks, international banks that did it, foreign countries, they will surprise you at how willing they are to take pennies on the dollar. Because guess what? They were always speculating. You know those banks that would have gone foul because of the mortgage packaging thing that happened, that would have totally gone defunct and sold off into different pieces, and that would have been the healthy thing to do? They expected that to happen. They thanked the Lord above when the politicians said, oh, you're too big to fail, you know. So that was gravy. They knew they were going down because they had taken speculatory risks, okay? And so I don't think it's a bad thing. We don't need revenue neutral. We need less money. We need to get back to constitutional government. It will hurt. It will hurt, but it will also be liberating to many people here. So that's my, I'm going to get the guy way, way in the back, and then I'm going to go to Dave. I'm sorry.
I wanted to ask you about ending foreign aid. I'm concerned about our allies like Israel, and also whether you think, you know, that our troops should be come home, we should bring all the troops home and do that.
I think most of the troops, I don't think most people in this country have any idea where our troops are at any given moment, what they are doing, you don't know, okay, and how many of them there are, and how much it costs for all those American bases that we have. If you knew that, you and I would be telling me, hey, there is a lot of stuff we shouldn't be doing. Okay, so yeah, I believe in bringing the troops home. I think, I believe in the Constitution. It says if you got a war, you declare it. It's got nowhere in the Constitution that says nation building. So yeah, I think there's a lot of ways we can cut. Now, does this country need to be defended by our military? I think so. So that's why I wondered, when Katrina happened, where was all the heavy earth movers? Well, they were in Iraq, 2005. Okay?
And about our allies, too.
Yeah, and south of the border, too. We need stuff going on there.
Israel is a... They'll come under attack because...
He has.
You know,
there's a lot of people.
Back and
Foreign aid is, and this is a Ron Paul quote. I'll give you a Ron Paul quote, and I think it's something that really explains foreign aid. Foreign aid is when they take money from the poor people in this country and give it to governments, the wealthy people in other countries.
I understand.
Yeah. So I would rebase it all. I would have it justified. I would see if it works for our interests. And Israel is not exempt from this examination. Let me tell you something about Israel. Well, you probably know. You probably tell me a few things about Israel. Well, first off, per capita income in Israel, about $26,000, $27,000 per capita income. What do you think their neighbors' per capita income are? Yes, Syria, Lebanon, Egypt, you name it. Even Saudi Arabia with all that oil money. Saudi Arabia's per capita income is like $14,000 a year. So, first off, we are taking money from poor people in this country and giving it to wealthy people in other countries. That doesn't apply to Israel. But let me tell you what's worse about foreign aid. And it doesn't matter if it's Israel or anybody else. When you, maybe this has parallels with the United States and China. When you take somebody else's money for free, is it really free? Is it really free? Or do they own a little piece of you? You know, one of the things we're concerned about China is China owns a little piece of us. We don't like that because they're a communist system, a statist system. They are an unfree system. And they do a lot of bad things to their people that we don't want to see done over here in this country if we can help it. So we don't like the fact that they own a little piece of us. Well, let me tell you, when we give $5 billion a year, okay, which is what we give to Israel, some of it gets spent back in this country. Okay, some of it is a gravy train for the military-industrial complex. We say, here's $3 billion. We give them $3 billion in military aid that has to be spent in American businesses. Okay, and they do that. So there's a little bit of benefit. So, well, that kind of benefits Americans to some extent, maybe. Okay, but $5 billion a year, year after year after year, in a small country like that, with not even 6 million people, 6.2 million people, I think, is all they have. They don't have a lot of people, and they're not growing as rapidly. They have, like, the European problem, you know? We don't have a lot of kids, and, you know, a lot of people go to college, and they say, hey, I want to go work somewhere else, I want to live somewhere else, you know, the expatriate. So Israel's a small country, getting all that aid. Well, how do you think they feel about that? You think maybe they feel a little bit like we feel when China gives us aid so they can pump up our country? You know, give us free good. Well, we got free good cheap stuff at Walmart. You know, well, they're not so bad. They're way far over there. Well, you know, the Israelis are not us. They are a little nation. They have sovereignty. That is a blessing. That's a blessing of sovereignty. You sell your sovereignty when you take what is so-called free money from some other country, especially a big one like us. And you know, a lot of people say, well, you know, Israel doesn't really. They're not really bound by that. But do you know what? They are. Are bound by that, okay? Because you are morally and ethically bound by that. No matter what you say, they don't like it, is what I'm telling them, okay? Israel could do a lot better for itself. Now, concerning Israel's security, well, first I'm going to tell you two things. One of them you might know, one of them you might not know. One of them is Israel's got a really good military, but you knew that. Yep. Let me tell you something else. We do not have in this country a mutual defense treaty with Israel. We do not have one. Don't have one. We wanted one. We've tried many times in this country. Hey, Israel, let's sign on. Let's be buddies. You know, we share. We have mutual shared value system. You know, we love you guys. Let's get a mutual defense treaty going like we have with so many other countries. And a mutual defense treaty means if you're attacked, you know, like NATO, man, you're in Cold War. Somebody attacks a NATO country, all of NATO comes to their defense. That included us. We were signing ourselves into war. Signed by the president, ratified by the Congress, okay? We wanted one with Israel, but Israel, to their great, great credit, has refused. Because why? Why do you think? Sovereignty. It is of critical, critical, critical importance, not just for us, and we need to recognize how important it is for us, okay? But it's very important for Israel's health, for Israel's sustainability. I hate to use that word, you know, Agenda 21 word, but... It's very important. So I don't think it's morally right to give a lot of free money. You make slaves of people. You make dependents of people. I know many of you have had kids. And when you have kids, sometimes you give them an allowance. Sometimes people give them, they say, well, I'm just going to give them an allowance. I'm going to have money. Other times they say, well, I'm going to give them an allowance, but there's got to be some payback, right? And normally we say, if you got to, if you're getting your allowance, you got to do some chores. You got to take care of the dog, make sure it gets water. Well, guess what? You know, that's how it works. When you take money from somebody, there is something expected in return. To Israel's great credit, they have not linked, yoked themselves in, with the United States defense. We're not yoked with them. But I would cut their, for very long explanation, but absolutely, and I think it's good for Israel.
One last question, and keep looking at
the
truth. No, we're good.
Oh, okay.
Dave is next, because I told him.
One first comment is that there's nothing in the Constitution that permits Congress to redistribute the wealth through foreign aid, right? And that, this is another socialist redistribution thing. The second thing is that, and I think I know where you are on this, but Bob Goodlatte is pushing the balanced budget amendment. It has a component of it that some Tea Parties like, but and I can't remember who they are, but. It puts a ceiling of 18% right now. And to me, that's a tacit consent to the status quo.
Yeah, it is.
And so what we're really doing is institutionalizing a color of law government instead of going back for a constitutional government.
Absolutely. Let me just clarify one thing, though. The one that they're voting on Friday night does not have that 18%. It's the so-called clean version, which compromised out even that limit, which, of course, is exactly, as you say, very wrong, okay? Because there's nothing in the Constitution or any constitutional republic anywhere on the planet that says you can't have one unless it spends 18% of the GDP. And, of course, that's a crazy number anyway. That's just like, you know, ask what the government says its inflation rate is, 3%. But how much more has the Thanksgiving dinner from this year to last year? Oh, that's 13%. So these are numbers, you know, statistics can be.
That's sort of out of the hat numbers.
I'm
thinking that the real thing we should be asking ourselves, if we're serious constitutionalists, in other words, if we really believe that the Constitution's the real deal, and we're willing to do the walk on this and be the real thing, we should be asking ourselves, what is the real approximate percentage of GDP a constitutional government would take?
Yeah, that's a good question, and that's where we should start. We should say, what does the Constitution require federal government to do? What's it going to cost in this year, 2010, 2011, in this century? What is that going to cost? You know, is defense going to cost more today than it did? Probably. But you know, there are a limited amount of things, and we should absolutely start from there. Just like you would if you were doing a business plan, you would say, what do I need for this, what do I need for this? What do I have to do? What are my core things that I have to do? The Constitution tells the government what those core things are. And that wouldn't amount to more than 1% of GDP to do that.
I'd like to have you add a couple of things to your list. First of all, we need to restore Christian values in our country. We don't realize, most of us here don't realize what is happening behind the scenes. Just like we have a group of Christians that oversee the House and Senate decisions that want to protect us from the Muslim world, which is right. And they're going to be disbanded by our president and the Senate in the vote next week. The other thing is the Democratic Republic. We talked about that. And we need to get back to a Democratic Republic, not a democracy.
No, a constitutional republic. Yes. A republic formed by law.
And we need
no democracy
to do,
in it.
And for our flag, which nobody talks about anymore.
Yeah. No, I agree.
Without that flag, we are not Americans.
That's true. But I have to say, and it's what I kind of mentioned already to you, the part of America that I'm very proud of is the part that connects directly to the Constitution and directly to the founders and to those values that you're talking about. That part of America I'm very proud of. Okay. I'll tell you this, and I'm 51 years old. Okay, I've said the pledge numerous times. I will continue to say the pledge numerous times. I grew up in the South, in North Carolina. And, you know, I was a conservative. But what I have seen, the growth of the federal state, okay, the growth of nationalism, not federalism, there are times, and I'm going to confess it to you, When I say the pledge, and I don't know if I'm pledging to the founders or if I'm pledging to Washington, D.C. And let me tell you something, I'm not pledging to Washington, D.C. Okay? Because I don't think it's bound by any law that I consent to or that the people before me consented to. So I have a little concern. I'm not overly worried about the flag. I know, I understand where you're coming from, but I'm not overly concerned. I think the Constitution is, you know, the flag is an image and it produces emotional reactions. You know, we see colors, we see the thing, if you ever hear the, you know, your heart beats, your eyes tear up, okay? But that's an emotional reaction. And I tend to stay away from those if I can. I'm angry, that's an emotion. But beyond that, I try to avoid it. And really what I want to see is legal, lawful, constitutional government. And I think if we had that type of government, we wouldn't be talking about the loss of Christian values in this country. We would not even be mentioning it because we would have a rich practice of Christianity in all of its forms throughout this country. Christianity is the dominant religion in this country, even today, even though there's a lot of concerns. It's the dominant religion, and it is a wonderful, wonderful thing. And, you know, it's assaulted not just by foreigners or non-Christians. It is assaulted by the very federal state that we are pledging to. Okay? Now, I don't want to get all radical on you, but that's how I see it. Okay?
That's how I see it.
And so I would not, if I had a choice of, well, do we go with constitutional government or do we all stand and look at the flag? Well, I'm going to go with constitutional government if that's my choice. Because that flag, in my life as a young person, is overwhelmingly associated, not with states, not with the Constitution, but with Washington, D.C. So I'm a little wary. But I understand exactly where it comes from, and I agree that that needs to be what we get back to. I think constitutional government would get us there.
Do you think abolishing the Federal Reserve is a good idea or not?
Well, I agree with the concept. I think that they should. I think the people that run the Federal Reserve need to understand that we are considering abolishing their jobs. I think that is very, very important because, that's the thing. Now, I'm not an expert on monetary policy. I oppose the Fed in principle. I'll tell you that. Okay. Do you want to abolish it overnight? This is where we get into the big problem with the global integration. Why did the Federal Reserve give $16 trillion in I think 2009 or whenever, including to Libya? $16 trillion. Didn't tell us about it. Why did they do that? Because they're owned by people that aren't even Americans. So we have a huge issue there. I say audit the Fed, and if that audit reveals substantial and unconstitutional weaknesses, abolish it. But I'm not going to say, oh, abolish it, because I want to audit it first. I want to see what's going on, you know? And also, too, just like this, when the Soviet Union collapsed, and you guys all know this, and other statist organizations that have collapsed, who were all the rich people in the Soviet Union after it became the Russian Federation?
Same guys running it, same darn communist power guys,
because they knew it was being abolished, and what did they do? They opened up their chests, and they swept all the goodies in there and enriched themselves and went on to the next phase. So I wouldn't say abolish it right away. I'd like to get the facts first, and that requires a complete and full and open, extensive audit. And I think if we did audit it, most Americans would actually demand that it was abolished. But let's go for the audit first. That's my thing. And I totally support that. I would be signing on to that in a heartbeat.
What are possibly a couple examples of votes that Good Latin did and that you would do differently?
Well, the two big ones that I constantly talk about are, he's raised the debt ceiling probably about 9 times. He did it every time George Bush asked him to, and that was 6 or 7 times. And he did it a couple times under Obama, most recently just this past summer, and it was a huge, huge increase, $2.4 trillion. And before that, it was like $1 trillion, $1.1 trillion, whatever, whatever. They're running about $1-point-something trillion over every year, so they have to ask for more money to borrow. Goodlatte consistently votes for that, okay? He's on record voting for that. I would not do that. I don't care what they threaten me with. I wouldn't do it, okay? And I would hope to inspire other people to oppose that as well. So that's one example. He also voted, he votes, and part of this is not his fault. Part of it is his fault, but a lot of it's not his fault. You know, they do the big omnibus thing, right? Omnibus budget. Well, how is Obamacare funded? Well, through a big omnibus. This is a funding. There's lots of stuff in it, you know. Well, Goodlatte voted to fund Obamacare. 3 times, I believe. 2 times, I'm sure of. One, I think he did 3 times. Because he voted to fund Obamacare. Goodlatte voted to fund Planned Parenthood. And you know what he said? He said, well, I voted against Planned Parenthood. I voted against funding Planned Parenthood. Little tiny, bitsy but a very moral and ethical issue. It's close to people's hearts, close to my heart. I don't think they should get any federal funding. Part of it's a redistribution thing. I think a lot of people shouldn't be getting federal funding, but Planned Parenthood in particular on the bad list. Okay. So they had thing. Well, let's pull their money. Well, Goodlatte said, okay, let's pull their money. We don't want to do that. And he did the right thing. He did. And then that vote lost. And so Planned Parenthood money was rolled up into the budget. He voted yes on the budget. Well, that's like voting for what you just said you didn't want to vote for. It's called compromise. He gets people like Boehner, his other buddies up there. He's been up there 20 years, you know, 19 years. He has friends. They say, oh, well, if you do this, you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back. Well, guess what? Nobody's scratching our back at the 6th District. Okay? Nobody's scratching the Constitution's back, and that's what needs to be happening. So there's three examples. He has made some good votes. Oh, I'll give you one that really burns me. Goodlatte this year has come out against ethanol subsidy. This year, 4 of the 5 agricultural counties in Virginia, in the 6th District, what do? We buy corn from the Midwest. We feed it to our cows. We feed it to our poultry. Okay? Yeah, we have a couple of cornfields. We make silage out of that for the dairy cows. Okay? Year after year after year, he voted for ethanol subsidies. When the people here were totally unserved by that. Now, you know, if he was from the eastern part of the state, I wouldn't have a problem with him doing that. Because they grow more corn, they sell corn, they want it propped up by government subsidy, which is wrong just in principle. When the Senate last spring decided that 9 years of ethanol subsidy was probably something we could go away from, we could cut that. When the Senate publicly on record said, we're not going to do it anymore, then Mr. Goodlatte pops up and says, oh, I'm against it. Oh, I'm opposing ethanol subsidies. That burned me. I'm sorry. Yeah. So for me, it's real simple. I'm going to look to the Constitution. I'm going to look to my conservative and fiscal conservative ethics. Okay. And I'm going to apply that to the vote. So when they say back 9 years ago, if I had been there, and they said, well, let's make a subsidy so we can burn corn and subsidize ethanol plants. How about that, Karen? You want to do that? And I'm going to say, subsidy? That's not in the Constitution. Burning up cow food and raising the prices for buyers? That's not good. Who said corn is the best source of ethanol? Anyway. Oh, I don't know. Probably Agenda 21 and scientists or something said that. Okay. So it would have been no problem for me. And he puts his finger up in the wind to see which way it's blowing, and then he makes his vote. So I could probably go on, but those are the three big ones. Budgetary issues really burn me. I think socially he's conservative. Socially I'm a conservative. So you're getting a wash with that.
You own cattle. Were you aware of Goodlatte promoting the implantation of RFID?
National Animal Identification System. This is actually, I should have mentioned it. My personal correspondence with Goodlatte was on that years ago. And he sent me back information, which was put together by a computer, I guess, that showed me he didn't know what the heck I was talking about and why I was concerned about it. And so I sent him another email. Knows nothing about agriculture, okay? Takes his money from people that don't work in the 6th District, okay? That's it. I yes, very much upset. He supports the USDA, lots of USDA programs that I don't support. National Animal Identification System, premises ID system. All you farmers, you want to take government money or you want to participate in their program, you got to give the premises ID. That's like a social security number for your farm, okay? And guess what? Oh, free social security numbers. That's nice. What do you get for free?
Nothing.
Yeah, so now, just like with these conservation programs, where they come in and say, well, here's some free money, fence off your streams. Oh, by the way, in perpetuity, government agents can come on your property at any time to inspect your work and to inspect the quality and the sustainability and did any trees fall down and you forgot to replant them. Okay, you sold your sovereignty. Okay, and Goodlatte doesn't even understand what I am talking about when I say that. He does not understand that. So, yeah, we come from different places. We absolutely do.
I asked Bob Goodlatte about a year ago, maybe a little bit, why he didn't join the Tea Party caucus that Michelle Bachmann had in Washington. He said, well, no one ever asked me, but she's a great friend of mine.
Yeah. That's interesting. And you know, it's funny, a guy that is well-connected as he is, that wheels and deals like he does, and we know that he does, because that's how he formulates his votes. He goes around and talks to a bunch of people, finds out what they want to do, and then he does it. Okay? So for him to say he wasn't invited or didn't know about it, he's not qualified. to be on any Tea Party caucus. Any group of people that think like we do, I'm telling you, Bob Goodlatte doesn't understand it. It's not a character flaw. He's just not educated in this way. He doesn't get it. So, and I think there were one more question in there. There we go.
What do you think of the idea of a page limit for congressional legislation?
Sounds fair. Sounds fair. But I'll tell you what it does also sound like. Sounds a little gimmicky. Let me tell you how I'm going to get your page limit for you. We already mentioned it up here. It's called Write the Bills. If the congressman had to write the bills, they couldn't call up to their favorite lobby and have them write this big, long, massive thing. But if the Congress had to write the bills, and the Congress had to read the bills, and they had to pass them one by one, you got your page limit right there. These guys are lazy, okay? They have no intention of working any harder than they have to. They'd much rather smooch it up with people, party, you know, get feted that when they come back home on how great they are. That's what they want to do. They don't want to write the bills. They don't want to read the bills. If you made them do it, they'd be short. I don't like making limits on things like that because it's a gimmick. Just like this balanced budget thing is a gimmick. Okay, it's all gimmick. Sounds good. Let's make a limit. This is off track a little bit. But there was a girl that my youngest son went to high school with. And she cheated all the time. She's a UVA man. And she cheated. She was the master cheater. I mean the master. She spent so much time cheating. I mean preparing cheat notes and things like that. And he actually brought home one that she had used for a test. The test was over with. It had done its job. But he brought it home for me to see what she used as her cheat sheet. I mean, it was a little tiny 2-inch by 2-inch square of paper with a very fine ink pen. And there was basically almost no white space. You would have to have extremely good eyes. I mean, at my age, obviously, I couldn't read it. But, you know, very finely, all of the notes. It was a biology test, so she had the facts, you know, the names of the animals, you know, the species, or whatever it was she was being tested on. She had all the detail down, the big words. Master cheater. Wonderful. I respect her for it, because, you know, I could never do that. But this is what they would do if you gave them a page limit. They figured out a way to, oh, well, it's a page on a computer, but it's got 25 links that hyperlink you to other things. Yeah. So don't bother with the limits and the gimmicks, because they're good at getting around and playing that game. Let's just make them write the bills themselves, read the bills before they vote on them, and do one bill at a time. And you will have a lot less laws, number one, and a lot shorter laws, a lot more clear laws. And because if you're doing it one at a time, I know I got to close here, but one bill at a time, making the congressmen work for their money, of course I would reduce their pay, but making them work for their money by reading the bills and writing the bills is for them. That's to make them better people, okay? And better law. But writing the bills with one topic at a time, that's for all of us. So that we can say, what you working on? Because, well, I got 10 bills here. Here's this one, it's 5 pages. Here's this one, it's 3 pages. And we, the citizens, we, the constituents, get a chance to see what they're doing. I go, oh, no, 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 no. No, no, you're not going to do that. Here's why. Not constitutional. I don't like it. And, you know, yeah, some people will want things and people will fight. That's the American way. You know, we'll fight for what we want. But at least we'll have access to what it is that they're doing. And that's going to be good for us. So there's lots of ways to make law. And we can do this right now. You know, we can renegotiate. We can recognize that we're in over our heads. We can deal with our problems. There is nothing that we can't deal with in this country. And so I just hope tonight you've gotten a few ideas of stuff that we can do. And it's not just that I can do it. If Goodlatte understood half of what was in this briefing, if he saw the briefing, he doesn't understand it, but if he did, he could go and do this himself. It doesn't take a good person or a strong person. He can compromise a little, but if he had these foundations, these fundamentals, he could do it. Anybody in Congress could do it. We can take our country back. I just want to say that because it a lot of times seems very overwhelming. But we can have constitutional government by the consent of the people. Dave, I was at your thing the other night. What do you say? Our precious consent. That's what we control. And if we don't grant it, they don't do it. And all we have to do is live by that. So anyway, but I've gone too long, and I appreciate your time. And I